Wow, thank you. Thank you so much for that, Matt. That was a blessing. We're so glad you've come this evening to Breaking Bread at 6. Whatever it takes to get comfortable, do that if you would. If you need another few ice cubes in your iced tea, do that and sit back and come and worship God with us. Enjoy this ancient liturgy that we provide in a very casual context. Please know that later at the midway through, right after the piece, the offering you leave this evening, your offering and tithe, it will represent the first fruits of your labor. It will complete your worship to God today and be used for the work of building up the kingdom here at Christ Church, the corner of 9th and Broadway. We are celebrating the Holy Eucharist. We're using Rite 2, and if your prayer book is at hand, it begins on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts. For as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. So, you mortal, I have made a sentinel for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked ones, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity. But their blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, but you will have saved your life. Now you mortals say to the house of Israel, thus have you said, our transgressions and our sins weigh upon us, and we waste away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 119, verses 33 through 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. I shall keep it with all my heart. Make me go in the path of your commandments, for that is my desire. Incline my heart to your decrees, and do not do unjust gain. Turn my eyes from watching what is worthless. Give me life in your ways. Fulfill your promise to your servant, which you make to those who fear you. Turn away the reproach which I dread, because your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your commandments in your righteousness. Preserve my life.
Ubi caritas. Et amor, ubi caritas.
caritas. Ubi caritas et amor. Ubi caritas. Deus ibi est. Live in charity.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you've regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
God's peace to you this day. I hope you are well and all of those you love are well. This is Richard, pastoral care coordinator here at Breaking Bread at 6, and I'm on my porch, or my wife and I's back porch in southeast Nashville, and this is like the first day in a month it's been under 90 degrees. It's a beautiful day, so I just thought I'd offer you some thoughts, a message from our back porch. You might hear something in the background, I don't know. Occasionally there's people sawing things, and a car horn went off a little bit ago, and there's the utility truck pulled up in front of the house, so I don't know what that's all about, but if it gets too noisy, we'll go inside. The 16th century poet John Donne was also an Anglican priest. He was the dean of St. Paul's Cathedral in London, and he served during a time of plague, which should sound familiar. Probably his best-known line from one of his poems is the one that goes, "No man is an island entire unto himself." Seems like we've been doing a lot of living alone, being islands these days. And, you know, we used to call people who lived alone hermits. I haven't heard that phrase a lot recently, but we are discovering, I think, that there are a lot of people living, especially in densely populated cities, living lives of loneliness and isolation. A few years back, maybe 2 years back, in the United Kingdom, they actually appointed a minister of loneliness to check into ways to alleviate that.
It's especially true now, of course, you know, with people working from home and increasingly. I heard somebody say this past week that the past 6 months have been felt like a cross between living in a monastery and being in a medium security prison, which may ring true for some of you. It really has been an isolated, lonely time for many. We humans are, it's a cliche, but we're social animals. We're gregarious creatures, and for most of our history, we've been gathering together in tribes and groups and villages and cities, communities of one sort or another. And communities, you know, can be good or bad. It's easy to think about bad for much of our history. As humans, we've been all about war and conflict, hatred for the other tribe, suspicion about the village over the other side of the mountain, and of course today's news reveals that we're still having a hard time getting along and understanding one another. Christian community is not immune to this. Almost from the first stirrings of the Jesus movement, sincere people of faith had disagreed. And if you want evidence of that, just start in the first chapters of the book of Acts and read on, and you'll hear of a lot of disagreements and arguments. And there's always been disagreements in the church, and Jesus offers today in the gospel reading some teaching, maybe a prescription for how to deal with disagreements that threaten the peace of the faithful. But even as we consider the dark and the sometimes negative side of community life, it's important that we not give into it. We have to confess it and own up to it and honestly acknowledge it, but we have to resist making peace with those things or those powers, if you will, that divide us as a community and isolate us from one another. I served as a Mennonite pastor for 10 years before I became a priest 15 years ago. Now, I'll never forget one of the Mennonite congregations I served back in Pennsylvania. Well, let me preface this by saying, in the Mennonite church, you only observe communion typically every quarter, around four times a year. And it's a very solemn kind of worship service. And there's much emphasis is placed not only on the bread and the wine, but also on the attitude of the heart and in reflection and repentance before receiving communion. And I'll never forget a church I served in Pennsylvania. One of the elders of the church would so there'd be like 50, 75 people gathered in the sanctuary of the church, and one of the elders of the church, who'd been around for many, many decades, walked up and down the middle aisle of the church, looking back and forth at people gathered there and saying, "Are you at peace with God and your neighbor?" The implication being, if you are not, if you have something against someone else in the church, then you should make it right before you come up to the altar. And that's based on a scriptural text. It says, before bringing your gift to the altar, make sure you're at peace, make sure you're... you know, there's no sin in your life before you come and offer yourself to God. So I thought that was so powerful, and it didn't, not everyone responded to that, but one or two people, I remember, got up from their pews and walked to the other side of the aisle or to the back of the church, and there was some hushed conversation, and something was settled that day. I don't know what, I'm not privy to that, but I just thought that was such a powerful moment. Jesus asks this of us. His life and his teaching, his ministry, all point to crossing borders, all point to reconciliation, the restoring of relationships. It's the work that St. Paul refers to when he speaks of all of us, every Christian, as being called to a ministry of reconciliation. Everyone who follows after Jesus is called to that particular ministry. Every congregation disagrees about things, you know, what's supposed to be on the website, disagrees about, you know, the mission or vision or some point of theology, tradition, the color of the carpet in the youth room, you know, the trick is to not allow ourselves to be divided by those things. Think for a moment about the greatest prayer of our church, which begins, our Father, not my Father, but our Father. It is a shared prayer for a shared faith, meant to draw us together. It's sort of a cliche, but we really are a family in which we are all sisters and brothers to one another. We are together in this. And in today's gospel, Jesus, you know, he gives us this admonition about settling disputes in church, but then he also reminds us of all the good that we can do together and how we can do it. He says, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am right in their midst. If any group of us gathers, will gather, work, and act with the Holy Spirit guiding us, with God's Spirit intentionally a part of what we do, and in peace, we will become much more than simply the number of people that we are. Two becomes more than two. Three becomes more than three. There's a synergy there in the presence of the Prince of Peace. We do gather in Jesus' name. We recall during the Eucharist his presence with us. That's what we experience in those Eucharistic prayers, in our liturgy. We in him, he in us. But we don't celebrate Eucharist alone, of course. You know, in the Anglican tradition, there are no private masses. If only the priest shows up for the midweek service, for instance, there won't be any celebration of the Eucharist because there's no community gathered to break bread with. Ours is a community of twos and threes and fours and thousands and millions, but never just of individuals. Our community truly is our lifeline. I must admit to you today that I really am equal parts hermit and whatever else I am, maybe more monk than hermit, I guess. I like people, I really do, but I also need time in my cave, in my monastic cell to recharge my batteries. And I need to have quiet, to tend to my inner garden, inner life. And those regular individual disciplines, prayer and meditation, are essential. But I think we've all realized afresh, anew, how important it is to be able to gather together and connect with our sisters and brothers in Christ's name, together walking the way of love in the footsteps of Jesus. It's been a real a rediscovery of the importance of corporate worship. Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. The connectedness just amplifies and multiplies and magnifies the Spirit for us and in us, with us. Jesus makes it clear today how important those relationships are and how important we are to one another. Through our link to one another, there is a power and peace to be found there in our community. I mentioned earlier the Mennonites, our friends in that tradition, the Mennonites, the Amish, the Church of the Brethren, Quakers, are collectively referred to sometimes as the Peace Churches or the Peace Church tradition. I heard someone once say that for Peace Church Christians, there is not just a path, a way to peace, but peace itself is the path and the way to flourishing, to abundant life, to the eternal life of which Jesus spoke. Something to ponder. We come together and we stay together and we live and love and work together in our Lord's name in the presence of God, which unleashes the power of the Spirit to transform our lives and the lives of all of God's beloved community. I pray for God's peace for you this day, for all one or two or three gathered together, and I'm so grateful that you joined us for worship. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, Presiding Bishop of the Episcopal Church, and John, the Bishop of Tennessee, and for all the clergy and people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless the missions of this congregation in Bolivia, Iraq, and Haiti, especially St. George's Church, Baghdad, Iraq. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Southern Africa, the Most Reverend Thabo Makoba, Archbishop of Cape Town, and Primate Southern Africa. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we remember St. James's Church, Dixon, and Calvary Church, Cumberland Furnace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. We pray for all those serving our country at home and abroad, and all those who suffer because of civil strife, that war may end and peace be established. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. For all teachers, students, and administrators in all places of learning. For those affected by the wildfires in the West, and for all those displaced from their homes. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Peace Richard, be Matt, with you. Peace to you both.
Peace.
Blessings
peace,
indeed.
Brother. Peace, Roger.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. And so we join the saints and angels in proclaiming your glory, and we sing. Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
This bread, drink this cup, come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not thirst. Eat this bread. this cup. Come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup. Trust in me and you will not thirst.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. So many to thank, those behind the scenes, those readers, the musicians today, Roger Rhodes in the loft, who is our sound tech each week. So grateful for that. Please come back next week. We're here each week, 6 p.m., Breaking Bread at 6 on the Christchurch YouTube channel. If you're new to this community, if you've tuned in for the very first time, please let us know you were here. You can leave a comment or send an email to a member of the clergy. You can pick up those email addresses off the Christchurch website. If you'd like any kind of additional information about Christchurch, about this liturgy, you can be in touch with Father Richard at rwineland@christcathedral.org. Owe nothing to anyone except love, for to love another is to fulfill the law. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Amen.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just. Just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There enough to last till the end of time. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another meadow. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and moonbeams enough to shine. Oh, listen, Lord, if you want to know.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.